as we now enter our new year and we start to see what's going to happen with cryptocurrency, I figured it's been a long time since I left you with a quarterly status SAITAMA address, mostly because hopefully you've noticed that going any further than quarterly is a waste of time. So there's not really much happening in the SAITAMA ecosystem, but there's a couple of things. Now, just a summary of where we left off. SAITAMA has not been able to recoup what it gained in 2021. There's a couple of factors at play here. One is social media sentiment is certainly down. Two is all these other projects that are spun up, including Cult, which are enticing people over to these other ecosystems. And for whatever reason, and I don't know what this is, but it seems like it permeates cryptocurrency. There's this notion that you must just YOLO, quote, into some one project as opposed to a diverse portfolio. Leicester here at CryptoTalkRadio.net has always advocated for a diversity of portfolio because I don't understand the logic of YOLOing into any one project or being only loyal, blindly loyal, as in Stockholm Syndrome loyal, to any one project. There was a form of Stockholm Syndrome with SAITAMA at a point, just like there's a form, or was, a form of Stockholm Syndrome with Seifu, a form of Stockholm Syndrome with SafeMoon, a form of Stockholm Syndrome with Cult now. There's just Stockholm Syndrome all over the place. And I don't know why. With SAITAMA then, what I was told, I got numbers that were thrown at me, but apparently SAITAMA peaked at about $7 billion in terms of market cap. A lot of money in the project. Unreasonable levels of pump leading up to the failed November 13th Vegas event. They did not deliver. It craps. It has never recovered. They do a V2. Close to 200,000 holders are left behind because they refuse to reach out for help to do these things. And that can only be described as ego. I actually have somebody following on Twitter who asked, and I believe she's from Japan, and she was asking, is SAITAMA a scam? And I said, no. And I'm speaking to her in her native language because, of course, Leicester is worldwide. Different area codes. But I don't believe it's a scam. I never have believed it's a scam. I believe you're dealing with incompetence. And I want to stress, at no point have I ever felt SAITAMA was a scam. It feels like you're just dealing with incompetent people, bottom line. Because I'm watching the fact that things are being delivered, but they're being delivered jacked up. And I speak as a software developer myself. They're just being jacked up, delivered. Project management is a nonsense nightmare. Their communication sucks. They don't go on neutral platforms. They only go on platforms that kiss their ass. Like, we're talking incompetence, ego to some degree. Old lady Christina with her quote, mama's new whip, you know, Russ and whatever he's doing with the weight and whatever he's doing with the blow and whatever he's doing with the Lambos and all this. It's incompetence. It's a bit of ego in what they're doing. I don't see scam. I never have saw scam. And I'll say that straight up. People can attack me. That's cool. But I've never seen scam at SAITAMA. I've seen incompetence. But if you heard me on many of my videos, I said it's equal bad if you got malicious intent versus incompetence for different reasons. Neither are good. You don't want incompetent devs running your project because it means the project's never going to succeed long term. And I don't like to see projects favor silliness. And SAITAMA favored silliness. What do I mean? I mean that SAITAMA largely banked on shill hype. And I don't mean shiller, although Jake Gagain did some shilling early on. I'm talking their internal hype, the Rust We Trust cult and, you know, mama's new whip this, and we're going to buy this, and we got this award that we bought this, and we're getting out of the US, we're setting up an LLC over here, this, and things that are not directly delivery. Because to me, sentiment is so hard damaged that if you don't focus on that first, none of the rest of the stuff you do matters. Because like today, anytime there's a project like, say, Terrarium, great example, a project that does something that looks shady as hell, everybody instinctively will say, oh, just like SAITAMA, deep, 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 because SAITAMA has now put a bad taste in everybody's mouths because of the way they treated things. And it's a shame because you shouldn't want, it's like car salesmen on Seifu. You shouldn't want, it doesn't matter if everybody knows who you are, if they think you're a scammer. And I stress, I'm not calling SAITAMA a scammer. I'm making the analogy with car salesman on Seifu. Everybody thinks he's a scammer. And what he did recently with Seifu seems to at least solidify that theory. With SAITAMA, I've never seen anything close to it, but I do see significant levels of incompetence, significant levels of ego, and just bubble, crypto bubble. They are so blind, deaf, dumb, and stupid as to what's going on around them. And the refusal, the absolute refusal to just go on neutral platforms and talk this out and say, and be open and say, this is what we did wrong. And for me, all I've ever wanted from them is to acknowledge what they got wrong. Openly acknowledge, put it out there so everybody understands, what did you get wrong? I want, you know, I want names, places, faces, people. in terms of what you did wrong. So I would start with the rise of the project. When it was first created, tell us about the situation. Tell us about the tokens that were given to whom and why, when they built that initial contract, because clearly certain people like Russ were enriched with tokens up front. No problem. But I think you need to put that out there and say, okay, yes, the new thing started up. They handed it over to us. They gave us a distribution of this many tokens, and our job was to make it succeed or fail. And if it didn't work, we got nothing for it. Great. Now that's out there. Now we know where you got your initial bag from. Okay. Leading up. Now, month over month, we saw it was dropping to zero every month. Why? What were you doing other than social media? Because we know that's crap. What were you doing to get there? Okay. We had some rich friends. We told the rich friends to dump into the project to help pump it. Okay. Put it out there. Put it on the table. That's what happened. Okay. If that's what happened, then we hear about this SAITAMask. At some point, you do a New York Times Square. You say it's going to do this. You're going to be able to download it on the event. That didn't happen. Tell us why. And most importantly, why didn't you call all these venues and say, you know, first, why did you say you're going to download it at the event and make that commitment when you couldn't promise it? Like, what? Tell us about these mistakes and why they happened. Some people will say, why do you care? I care because you have to understand what went wrong in order to know what to fix. Bottom line with SAITAMA always has been poor communication that for people feel like lies. They feel like they're being lied to. If you feel like you're being lied to, that's harming your sentiment. So let's understand why you keep presenting something that's not factually true. And no, you can't keep saying, oh, I just messed up. Same thing happened with Para, used to be Para Token, where they kept putting out there, oh, we messed up, we made a mistake, and they went from V2 to V3 and V4 and all this. At some point, when do you stop making those mistakes if they are truly mistakes? And at what point do you acknowledge, okay, maybe we're not cut out for this and we need to hand it over to somebody who's a little bit more competent? Okay, so do you drop Max? Was it really Max? Because since his departure, we haven't seen anything significantly move forward except Saita Pro. That's one deal. Okay, but there's swaps all over the place. You haven't given a strong case as to why somebody should use your swap over other swaps, especially with QuackX, which I think very highly of, frankly, blows away anything Saita Pro is doing. So again, I think that talk through is critical because what it's going to help do is rebuild trust of investors to hear straightforward answers, at least at a point that you go on a neutral platform that's not trying to kiss your ass and ask you hard questions about what went wrong and take it on the chin, take that smoke. Because they refuse to do it, again, I think that just makes it worse. And so now you're in this huddle state and they're banking off of the rise of Ethereum again to help their price. It might, it should, but the bottom line is if your people are still dumping on SAITAMA, it's not going to do any good. And if nobody's buying in, it's not going to sustain. You've got to address the sentiment problems. If you don't, none of the rest of the crap you're talking about doing is going to make a difference. And I guarantee you, FANG's not going to make a damn bit of difference. Not because you're not doing hard work. I see the work. I don't think it's what people want. I think people are tired of NFTs. I'll maintain that statement. More importantly, though, when we talk about this site of realty, okay, I heard the messaging about it, and then somehow it turned into some kind of a metaverse type thing, and everybody knows how I feel about metaverse. So at some level, man, I am not at any point telling you to buy or not buy SAITAMA because I can't tell you what to do with your money. I can't tell you what's going to happen with the price, other than I do know there are people who are waiting to dump off the project. That's clear from the blockchain and clear from past activities. I know that to be the case. I do know volume is way down. I know SAITAMA is on enough exchanges that it's very easy to dump off the project. This we know. I do know it's not renounced, and I don't support that it should be. I think what happens with renounce is you should use EverOwn and EverLock so that it's not renounced officially, but at least you have to go to the community and ask their permission if you want to do something to the code. I know they don't want that smoke, but that, to me, would show good faith. It would show we're putting it in a tool that's tried and tested, that's going to protect the contract, and ultimately, going forward, the community runs this because they claimed it as a community token and have not behaved like it's truly a community token. Instead, they behaved like it's their own personal piggy bank, and that's what has contributed to some of this damage. Everybody is free to do whatever they're going to do. I do encourage you to check out coinmarketcap.com and check through the comments and see how people are feeling because it's important. It's very important because what it's going to tell you is that everything I'm saying is likely more the case. We're not talking scammers. We're talking incompetence. Things like charging for debit cards. Mind you, debit cards are free on various other services that I can call out like crypto2card.io. So it's incompetence. We're not talking people that are really trying to rip you off. They don't understand and they're trying to put something out there and they're not learning from others that are already doing something better than they could do. So they have nothing that stands out as superior to other services. If you can't stand out as superior to other services when there's so much competition out there in the space, you're not going to get anywhere. Short term, it is what it is, and you might see green off the Ethereum jumps and runs. Long term, it's not going to get to a point where it's able to move the needle, truly move the needle, because they haven't fixed the sentiment problem, one. Two, the approach to what they're doing is not learning from the mistakes of other projects. And they're putting stuff out there thinking that it's a good idea, and they're not talking to conservative platforms to describe to them why certain decisions are stupid, or at least justify why they must do it. Like, maybe in some country, they're required to charge X because of this statute, okay, go on a platform and explain that. And then let's prove it. And as long as you're telling the truth, then it's probably okay. That's not what it is. What it is they're trying to have places where they can generate sources of revenue. And they're trying to drive that profit upward on a constant basis. So they're coming up with all these gimmicks that they think is going to work. And the bottom line is it's not going to work for the same reasons that they didn't work in other places. So that's my quarterly thoughts on SAITAMA. As I said, it probably is going to be the last that I do, because there's not really much in significant movement at this point. I may revisit it in 2024, because 2024 is when we're expected to see stronger run-up. When we get stronger run-up, that means because they're paired to Ethereum, they should in theory benefit from it. And the measure, and this is my call to action to you, if we see that Ethereum starts running up to the estimated $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 per coin, and SAITAMA is still hovering around with two zeros, it'll just tell you what I'm saying is the truth, which is it doesn't matter at this point how your liquidity is performing, because you haven't solved the underlying problem. SAITAMA could very well turn something around and spit out some amazing something. But I think at this point, because they refuse that smoke and they're not fixing their sentiment issues and they're not going on neutral platforms to explain and tell the truth about all this crap that's been going on, I think it's not going to go significant places. And let's hope that I'm wrong and kind of leave it at that.